So yeah. where do you see this housing market heading?
So we have different factors now compared to 2008. We don't got the same ninja loans. We don't got the same subprime mortgages, the same 0% or 105% loan to value loans that we saw back then. But what we're seeing now is we have, like you were saying, just Zillow used to be in the business of buying homes, trying to flip them and sell them for a big profit. You know, they weren't doing a lot. They were trying to just do a little bit of cosmetic work and trying to flip them for a profit. But they came out and said that they're stopping that business because they're worried about the housing market and they cannot sell the inventory that they have. Then we're starting to see an uptick in foreclosures, which makes sense. We had no foreclosures last year. Now we're seeing a lot more, but compared to pre-pandemic levels, it's still relatively low. We have a housing market slowdown. People are looking at the housing prices and saying, I can't afford this anymore. So they're walking away while more home inventory is hitting the market. So we're starting to see a housing market cool down. Now, the question is, where do we go? Are we going to go down? Are we going to go sideways? Or are we going to kind of just go up slowly? Well, the risk factors that we have now are different in the sense that if we look at just the housing market in a bubble, it doesn't look as bad because, yeah, we have some issues. Home prices are really overvalued and people's incomes are not rising with home prices, which is not good, but compared to what we saw before 2008, it's not as bad as that. But the bigger issue is the economic factor, everything that we've just been talking about with like inflation and potential economic slowdown, stagflation. If that continues, we see a slowdown in the economy. People don't have jobs. Then how are they going to afford their mortgages? How are they going to afford buying another home? And if that happens, well, then now you do have another real estate slowdown, not caused directly by the housing market, but caused indirectly through the economic market because people don't have the means and the ability to afford these crazy home prices. And, you know, you have to think about it. Like, if home prices are growing like this and wages are only growing like this, there's going to be a point where people are not going to be able to afford homes because people just can't, their wages aren't growing with it. I mean, back in a couple of generations ago, it was a one-income household that supported everything. A guy went to work and the woman stayed home. I'm not saying it's right. That's just what it was. And that income was able to support buying a home and everything else. Now we have two income households. You'd think that people are wealthier now than before, but they're not. They're struggling more now. And people are talking about not just having a two income household, but you have two incomes and a side gig in order to afford this. And when is it that people are going to get tapped out as the price of things keep growing? Because it's not just the housing market. It's the price of everything, everything that keeps growing. And what's interesting to me, we talk about risk factors. I like to ask all of my banker friends, like, how's the housing market? Are people still buying homes like crazy? Just to kind of see what they're saying. And what I've been hearing more is, yeah, it's slowed down, but you know, people are still buying homes and people are taking out these the adjustable rate mortgages to help out with these interest rates. I said, what are you talking about? And they're like, yeah, you know, they don't want to lock in a 3% for 30 years. So instead, they go into an ARM for 5 years and locking in, you know, 1.99%. I was like, you're saying people can't afford a 3% mortgage? So they're going to an ARM, an adjustable rate for, 1% less? And that's what's scary. And I actually recorded a video today on that. And as I was recording the video, I got an email from Ally Bank marketing email saying, adjustable rate mortgages are here for jumbo loans. So we are here to help you with that. And that's what's scary to me because now as we're seeing the market slow down, what is going to happen that is out of our control? Are we going to see more risky loans? And if so, what is that going to lead to? If you're taking an adjustable rate mortgage right now, when you can lock in a 3% mortgage, what is going to happen in 5 years? And the email says, don't worry, you will be able to refinance in 5, 7, or 10 years. I mean, this is like something I screenshotted. I was like, you got to be kidding me. Like, did we not just see this exact same marketing happen 12 years ago, 13 years ago? So that's my concern.
Right. You can refinance your home as long as your credit's good, your income's good, the home is worth what you're refinancing it for, et cetera.
As long as home prices keep going up, you can refinance.
Exactly.
Yeah. And folks, like, but you, like, if you want to see where, you know, this is what we call a red flag. like if you want to see where a bank wants you to borrow from, this is a red flag. This is adjustable means that it goes up and down based on the terms of the loan. Fixed, of course, means you're hedging inflation all day long. So a lot of, most of the people, unfortunately, as you know, they're gonna pour their money into these because it's gonna be a lower payment, and they're gonna pay. It's gonna be a short term deal, and they're gonna pay for it later, right?
Absolutely, and it's unfortunate. You know, we assume that your home can only go up, that your home is an asset that will make you wealthy. It is the thing that can drive prosperity, home ownership. And sure, if your home value goes up, it can make you feel wealthier. But at the end of the day, it is the place that you live. And what happens if home prices go down? Now your asset turns into a money pit. And even between the time between you buy it and you sell it, you're going to want to renovate your kitchen and renovate your bedroom and upgrade the basement and upgrade the yard. All these things just keep sucking money out of you when that money could be used to buy, I don't know, a rental property, which is paying you every single month. And when you do these renovations, you get a tax break for them. So there's nothing wrong with owning a home. Just make sure you can afford it, especially in markets like this.
Yeah. And, you know, we actually were talking about that today on our show earlier. You know how rental prices are going up exponentially as well. And that if you can lock in that fixed rate debt, it may be worth it for you, especially if it makes your monthly payment cheaper.
Yeah, and exactly. But the one concern that I would have is just make sure you're not overpaying. Because I was looking at some properties. I was in Texas not too long ago, and there was the properties being marketed as, you know, 1 caps, 0.5 caps, 1.25 caps, meaning they're 1% returns on your money. If you invest $1 million cash to buy a property, you're going to make $10,000 a year. And the whole sales pitch is, don't buy the property based off of today's rental values. Assume that rental prices are going to go up by 5 to 10% a year, every single year. So in 3 years, you're going to be, you know, in the green, you're going to be making so much money. I don't like that type of speculation. I don't personally like to invest based off of what rents are going to be in 3 years or 5 years, because what happens if that doesn't happen? What happens if the economy slows down? So yes, you know, buying real estate investments is great, but what I'm doing is I'm just being pickier. And I'm making sure that when I buy properties, I'm buying them based off of today's rental prices, not next year's or the year after that. And then, what that does is that allows me to price in a potential decrease if we do ever see an economic slowdown. I can't predict the future. If it slows down and we have to cut rents, I don't want to be the person that's not paying the price. I want to make sure that I factor that in there. So if we see upside, great, I benefit. If we see downside, it's okay. I projected that. I'm ready for that.
Yeah, I always like to say, trust but verify, right? You know, I put that in my book, The ABCs of Real Estate Investing, but I'll tell you a funny story. My partner and I, we decided that we had a property in Houston, Texas, of all places, that was just okay. It was kind of flat rents, and, you know, we manage it, by the way. So we were trying to force some value through capital improvements and things like that, and we just couldn't move the needle. Our own management company, we were trying. And we went and upgraded some units, and the market was saying, hey, we can't get any more rents. So we said, listen, we have a lot of equity. Let's sell it and move that money, Velocia money, into something else. It was a small property, like 150 units. So, which also drove the expenses a little bit higher, as you know. So we listed it, and it went out to market and went into escrow, which we were happy with. So we're on the phone with the potential buyers, and we get it into escrow. Lo and behold, you love this. I get the business plan from the buyer. So now I'm the seller, but I'm also, they're pitching me to invest in it, into their fund, which is buying this property. And so I opened the business plan, and of course it says, look at these great increases you're going to be able to get in rent. We're going to be able to save on expenses. We're going to upgrade all the units. Yeah. And this is a property I own. And they're pitching me as a,
horrible management company.
It was the greatest. And so my partner and I were laughing. Hilarious. We opened it up. And to your point, anybody can say anything and sell the future, because if it's in the future, it's actually not a lie, right? But it doesn't mean that it's going to happen. And so you have to trust but verify the data inside of a business plan or from a seller or from a broker. You can't just buy something and expect that it's going to work out and produce the returns that you think, right?
If you enjoyed this short clip from my longer videos, here's another clip that I think you'll love. And while you're at it, if you're interested in learning more about how to start generating passive income, our team put together an amazing guide that goes over what passive income is, how to start generating passive income, and different passive income strategies. These are things that you can start doing even if you don't have a lot of money. So if you want to read this free guide on how to start generating passive income for free, all you got to do is click that button right over there. Thank you for watching, and as always, keep hustling.